the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel pain. On earth is not his evil. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. And though this world with devils fill should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God has willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fail him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abided. The Spirit and the gifts are ours, through him who with us sided. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill. God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming
love. Well, I hope all of you are doing well. We are going to get ready to start our video for lesson 12 of Living in the Times of the Sign, and just hoping and all of you are doing well and having a great day, and especially as I'm getting some things squared away here. So give me just a moment as we are lining everything up and So give me just a moment here. That's where I want. Okay. So, but again, hoping all of you are having a great day, doing well, and obviously also staying dry as well too. So I know, and we need to remember those, especially over in the Tampa area and over on the West Coast, that are dealing with the impact of Hurricane or Tropical Storm Eta. And so, but glad all of you are doing well. So today is lesson 12. Can you believe it? Three months in, and we are doing the Living in the Times of the Sign. And also, too, just want you to know, I do not think that we are having a lesson next week, but I would double check that, make sure that we are not. But I believe that is the case. It would be the next 2 weeks in regards getting ready for Thanksgiving. And then there'll be 2 weeks in December during the holiday breaks and things. So please just make preparations for that. And I think we'll have 2 weeks off. Everybody enjoy time with family and friends. Always check in here whether or not we're going to have it, and you'll find out real quick. So let's do a little review and a recap of where we have been just very briefly. So in chapters 2 and 3, we had the letters to the seven churches. Chapters 4 and 5, we had the scenes in heaven. Chapter 6, we had the first six seals. Chapter 7, we had the sealing of the 144,000 Jewish witnesses. And also we saw there at the latter half of Revelation chapter 7, the tribulation saints. So that's where we are in our study that we have. So today we're going to talk about the first and the second trumpet, that's supposed to be judgments. This is going to be kind of a quick lesson, because if we were to take all of them, we would be here way too long. So let's take a recap of where we were last week. In verses 1 through 6, we see, now we're back in chronological time. Remember that chapter 7 is one of those first parenthetical passages where it is non-chronological. So understand that it is not chronological. Let me just get some things set up here. It's not chronological in time. And so now when you hit chapter 8, it is chronological again. Remember, as I said before, heaven is an eternal place, but here is one of the first times that we do see a scripture where time was measured in heaven, and it was measured for about half an hour for 30 minutes. And then he said, I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and to them were given the seven trumpets. So these angels stood before God. We don't know if they've always been there since eternity past. Since they were created, we know that the four living creatures have always been there, but maybe these seven angels are on the peripheral. And so they were given seven trumpets, and then another angel having a gold censer came. And so this one is has the prayers of the saints. So that's where we are now. So now we're going to talk about the first trumpet judgment. Let me read to you Revelation chapter 8, verse 7. The first angel sounded, and hail and fire followed, mingled with blood, and they were thrown to the earth, and a third of the trees were burned up, and all green grass was burned up. So the first of the seven angels blows his shofar. As we mentioned last week, there were two types of trumpets used in the Old Testament. The shofar, which this is what we believe is mentioned here, or a small metal trumpet, usually made out of silver, but that was usually done in regards to feast and celebrations. Shofar was usually used in reference to calling the people of Israel together, and that small metal trumpet would have had a very high shrill. Most scholars believe it is a shofar. This is the first trumpet judgment. The sounding of this trumpet brings the sounding of different opinions as to whether the judgment is literal or symbolic. So, as I have mentioned to you before, you take everything in Revelation as literal unless you see from Scripture and the text that it is not. This seems to be literal. It doesn't seem to give you the suggestion as fire or as hail or as like blood. No, it says that it was those things. It says that in hell and fire mingle with blood. It doesn't say as or like a simile or any type of metaphor. It's saying that it is literally, that it literally takes place. So there are some things to consider as to whether this is literal or symbolic. If not literal, why would John be so precise in recording how much vegetation was destroyed? There would be no reason why. If it was all metaphorical, symbolic, simile, or just using as an illustration, would be, John would have no reason as to give the specific amount of vegetation destroyed. This judgment is very similar in scope and method to the seventh plague on Egypt, hell and fire, or lightning. The fire could be lightning. Now, the blood mingled there, obviously we know that blood was not there in that plague, the seventh plague. The blood was there in regards to the water being turned to blood, but not here. So this is very similar to the judgment that God gave Egypt all the way back in the book of Exodus. Most scholars agree that the plagues happened in Egypt. They were literal plagues. The way it would work, or the way that most scholars believe that it did work, is that the plagues that were brought upon Egypt, the 10 plagues, took the course of a year. And if you think about it, remember that our God's a God in order, that he would do these things. And this would be over. If you think about how when you kill the frogs, well, if the frogs aren't there to eat the gnats or the flies, then what happens? There's an explosion of insects. And so God happened and brought all these ecological disasters on there, but it was a divine sovereign judgment on Egypt, not some type of natural disaster. First off, know that anything, well, let me just back up. God is the one who controls and does all things. So let's just say that. And he is the one who brought the disasters on Egypt, whether through by natural process or by a divine miracle. It all happened, and it happened in order. And if you go back and look, you can see how it would happen in order through an ecological disaster, or the way that it would happen. But it was caused by God. And first off, it was all caused by God because he turned the water into blood. So God does these great things in Scripture, and God is not doing this to be mean. He is not doing that. He is doing it to draw people to himself. He wanted the Egyptians to be drawn to himself, and they would not. He wanted Pharaoh to be drawn to him, to repent of his sins, to turn to him, to trust God. And what did Pharaoh do? He did not. He hardened his heart, and God also hardened his heart, and Pharaoh finally would relent, but also would double back on his relenting. So that's what happened. So if this happened in Egypt, then the same is true that it would happen here later on. So we see that is taking place. Hold on, somebody. Sorry, folks. Okay, give me just a moment. I've got something. Okay, sorry. I know everything's messed up. Somebody was trying to get in on Zoom and kind of messed that up there. So if this plague happened in Egypt, then it can lead a people or a person to conclude the likelihood that this judgment would happen in the future in Revelation chapter 8, verse 7. So the first trumpet judgment, hell, fire, and blood. We know that hell and fire, lightning, can take place in storms, as it was in Egypt. Moses, through the Lord's power, calls the greatest supernatural storm in history. Therefore, hell and fire / lightning are not foreign to Scripture as a judgment. We do see this. And so, and again, remember that God will use natural things in order to bring divine things. How do I know that? Noah's flood. Flooding is natural, but the miraculous part of it, the whole world was judged. We know that storms with hail and lightning or fire are natural, but over an entire country at one time, or even over the planet at one time, that's the supernatural part of the aspect of it. Hail, fire, and blood. Again, however, what is the meaning of the blood? So was it, you know, animal blood, human blood? What is it? One commentator states that the blood is from inside the hail. This is possible given the judgment is given by God, making it divine, and he can cause this to happen. Another explanation is that the blood is from those judged during the judgment. The problem is that the judgment seems only to affect nature. This is in regards to the next three judgments. So it seems to be that the first four of the trumpet judgments are natural ecological disasters. So could the blood be from the hail hitting animals and blood just going everywhere? Could it be that it is it is supernatural, but that it is also supernatural that the blood is inside the hail? That is also a possibility. So where do we stand on this? Well, we have to stand where scripture stands. And the only thing that I can tell you, it says that it was mingled with blood, either on the inside or as it is hitting creation and hitting animals, blood is going everywhere. So that's all that we can say. And we have to be clear in that. So that's the only, so again, you'll hear me say this, I can only go where scripture takes me. So the hail and fire, however, what is the meaning of the blood? Well, one conclude that the hail and the fire or the lightning will happen, and so to the blood, but where the blood comes from, we can, again, only speculate. We're not exactly sure where it comes from. Is it coming directly from God? That could happen. Or is it coming from animals that are being hit? That could happen as well. We're just not entirely sure. The judgment's casualties. The judgment was thrown to the earth. It implies a violent action bringing harm and destruction. Notice it is to take place on the earth and does not affect the skies or the oceans. So in addition, this judgment is on nature, not humanity. And not only that, it's also really on vegetation, because it says 1/3 of the trees are burned up and all green grasses were burned up. So in some versions, like the New American Standard, the English Standard Version, the Message, the Living Bible, the New International Version, the Revised Standard Version, or the New Living Translation, they use the term 1/3 of the earth will be burned up. However, in the Authorized Version, the phrase is not used, it's implied. Authorized Version would be a synonym for King James. It is rightly noted and concluded that 1/3 of all large vegetation and grasses will be destroyed. And we'll get to that in a moment. The individual accounts of the casualties are mentioned next. So 1/3 of all trees are destroyed. All green grasses are destroyed. So if you're like me and you like having a pretty lawn, or you like looking at golf courses or any type of manicured landscape, guess what, folks? They are gone. So think about all the time and effort that we spend in making our yards look great and having awesome plantings and trees and shrubbery and palms and all that stuff. Folks, listen, when this judgment happens, it's gone. We're now into the last 3.5 years, and this is all gone. So all the time that we have spent in our yards, was it wasted? No, I don't believe it is, because we are showing that we're good stewards of the creation that God has given to us. So just kind of put everything in perspective and just to bring a little bit of levity. So the outcome of the judgment. So think about it. If all the trees are, or if all 1/3 of the trees on earth are gone and all green grasses are destroyed, think about this. Earth's oxygen levels will be lowered. Also, air quality will become poorer and hazardous. Food supplies for humanity and animals will become scarce. This will put a run on all grains and other produce. This will lead to a certain economic collapse or come very short of this, if it has not already happened. So you got to think about that. Now, I want you to understand this, that most of the air that we breathe does not come from the rainforest. It actually comes from the oceans. It comes from microscopic organisms that produce oxygen. So that's where most of the oxygen that we breathe, a good majority of the Earth's oxygen comes from the oceans, but not from the rainforest. So still though, trees and shrubbery and plants and grasses are filters, just like the oceans are, but they are filters for all the particulates in the air that we have. So imagine 1/3 are gone. You know, if people have asthma now, they're really going to suffer it during this time if they are left behind. So now let's look at the second trumpet judgment. It says, then the second angel sounded and something like, okay, now that is a simile. So it's not literal, but it is like that. So something like a great mountain, a mountain burning with fire, was thrown into the sea, and a third of the sea became blood. Now, what does that mean? We'll get into that into just a moment, because it was like a great mountain burning, and we can kind of speculate what that probably is. We read with John about the second judgment. This judgment consists of a great fiery and burning mountain thrown into the sea. This is a contrast with the first trumpet judgment. So the first one, here's how it's contrasted. The first trumpet judgment dealt with the earth. Now this one deals with water. First, again, with land. The second one deals with oceans and seas. This event will affect everyone on earth, not just in the impact area. The great fiery and burning mountain can be one of two things. One of two things. It could be an underwater supervolcano like that of the super caldera in Yellowstone National Park. If you don't know that, Yellowstone National Park is just really the inside of a super volcano. The second, it could be an asteroid. This is probably more likely to the case, because it says here that it was thrown into the sea. So you can think of a asteroid, a meteorite striking the planet, striking the seas. You know, there seems to be evidence of this in Earth's past. And remember, I think our Earth is no more than 6,000 years old. And so we kind of think that this has probably already happened. As asteroids approach the Earth and then make contact with Earth's atmosphere, gases and liquids are released. This would and does give the incoming object the appearance of being on fire as it is coming in. Think about the movies of Deep Impact and Armageddon. As these celestial objects are coming in contact, they look like they're on fire. They look like they're burning, and especially a big one. So you can imagine that it would have that appearance. And remember the reason why John describes it that way. John is using first century vocabulary to describe future events. John is going to see things that he has never seen before. So he's going to have to describe it with the vocabulary that he has during that time. So in regards to the mark of the beast, that's the descriptive term that he gives. He doesn't understand about microchips and microprocessors or computers. He doesn't understand that. So John is going to be using descriptive terms that he has in the first century to describe things that are happening 20 centuries later. So we read that one third of salt water is contaminated. Better explained, this event is probably a localized event, and that the oceans and the surrounding area are directly and indirectly affected. The aspect of the blood in the water is debated, because it says just one third of the seas became blood. So wherever this asteroid impacted, it's going to affect that area. Now, it will have global ramifications, but in that localized area, it'll happen there. So so I'm sorry, folks. People are coming in, so I apologize for how this looks. So okay. So water turning to blood. Well, we know this has happened in Earth's history before, there in Egypt. Since this is a supernatural event, blood could be embedded in the asteroid. That could happen. However, this seems highly unlikely, because if it was coming in at such a high velocity and such high heat, doubt it that it would be able to happen that way. But it always can. The asteroid could contain some element that would cause the water to turn red. That's also a possibility as well. We're not talking about rust. The asteroid could cause red algae to form. And we know that red algae is very deadly to oceanic life and also to freshwater life. We know that red algae blooms in lakes or in the oceans. It'll kill anything in there, because what does it do? It will extract all of the oxygen out of the water, and anything in that area will just completely die. So in red algae blooms that happen, that's why there is just this huge flush of dead sea life, because especially that uses water to breathe, i.e. fish or any type of crustaceans or anything, not mammals, but it'll kill it. And so that's why this would be a very bad ecological disaster in any form. And so it'll be bad. It says water turning to blood. One, a fourth explanation is that the loss of life in the one third of the waters and surrounding areas would cause the oceans to turn bloody. So if you have all these animals dying and they're decaying, their blood would be released in the water. That's also a possibility as well. Lastly, some say that the ash ascending into the atmosphere would give the water a reddish color because the sun would shine in a reddish color. So if this asteroid impacts, it's not going to be dissolved in the water. It'll pass all the way through the water, hitting the Earth's crust. And then with that impact, it would release things and it could turn the water but it does say it became blood, so we have to think about it. And again, John is describing events he has never seen before, nor does he have understanding. So here's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to give you every reasonable explanation of why it says that it is turning to blood. Is it literally animal or human blood? Don't know. It doesn't say that it turned to human blood. It just says blood. So what is it? So I have to give you all these explanations and just cover a broad basis. But there it is in Scripture. So I'm just trying to do justice to Scripture. It is best understood that a combination of explanations 2, 4, and 5 to be the best. Now, let's go back and review that. Again, since this is a supernatural event, blood could be there. That's also a possibility. Explanation 2, asteroid contains some element that would cause it. Also, 2, it could be that it caused a red algae bloom. And then also number 5, that it released some type of ash into the atmosphere that could cause it. Maybe even explanation 4 or 2 and 4. But so it is 2, 4, and 5. All these explanations are easily explained and foreseeable and conceivable. And think about it too, that the first trumpet judgment and the second trumpet judgment, these are ecological events. So it could be that God sends this asteroid and hits the planet and causes an ecological disaster in the oceans. Very foreseeable, and it's still divine. Whether or not there's blood in the asteroid or whatever, it's still a divine, supernatural judgment on the earth. All right, the casualties, we read that one third of all sea life in the area dies. This is foreseeable of where it hits, and one third of all merchant travel and commerce is disputed, because look in verse 9, and a third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships destroyed. So it could be foreseen that this celestial body hit somewhere in the Pacific Ocean. The Pacific Ocean is the largest ocean on the planet. That's where most of sea travel happens. It is so bad that it affects all travel in that area. And so one third of all sea life dies in that area, and all third of merchant travel dies, which would be representative of the entire planet. So one third. So all sea life in that area dies, which is one third. And then all sea traffic in that area all sea traffic, which would be one third. So we could easily understand that. That's no problem at all. But imagine that this celestial body is that big that it would really disrupt the natural order of things and also the commercial order of things to that point. It happens in a localized area, but has a global impact, not just ecologically, but also economically as well. If the effect of the first judgment did not have any marked level of impact on the world's oxygen supply, this judgment will. And most of the world's O2, again, comes from phytoplankton in the water. And this will cause more life to die on Earth, maybe smaller life forms. So one third of the trees are gone, all the grasses are gone, and now one third of all phytoplankton from the oceans are gone. Folks, listen, there it's going to be hard to breathe. And then you have all this stuff being spewed into the atmosphere. And then you have all these things burning on the land. People are going to have severe asthmatic issues. So the first judgment impacted the economy, but with this more likely devastate any rebound of the economy after the third seal. So the outcome is just, so with one third of the merchant fleet destroyed, goods and services will come to a literal grinding halt. We've kind of experienced this during COVID-19. when everybody was on lockdown. It was hard to get toilet paper, for Pete's sakes. It was hard to get cleaning wipes, hand sanitizer, soap. And then that continued on down when it was hard to get meat, hard to get produce. So we can understand how this would have a global impact. So folks, it's going to be interesting times. And so, again, what should this cause us to do? It should cause us to witness to people, to tell them about who God is and what he's about, because we don't want anyone to experience these traumatic events on the earth, because it will not be all that well. So, hey, just know that through all this, even though it is gloom and doom, remember Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19, Jesus comes back. He makes a new heaven and a new earth. We come back with him. People will be redeemed. People will be saved if they make it through the end. They will be saved from that, and it'll be a glorious time. All right, so I told you it was going to be a little short, but had I add the other ones on there, it'd have been way too long. So it's kind of a give and take there. So thank you for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed the rest of your lunch hour. Don't forget that this Sunday is going to be a great day in God's house. It'll start at 10:30. Don't forget Bible study starts at 9 o'clock here at Downtown Baptist Orlando. If you can, invite people to come to church, folks. It'll be a great time for all of us to worship our great God and King together. Have a great weekend. Stay safe. And if you're in the Orlando or in Florida, stay dry today as Hurricane Ida, or Tropical Storm Ida, continues to go through. So be safe and love each and every one of you.